Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Way of Hope this morning. It's good to see you here at the Queen Mahoning Rec Park. Just a quick note, we up Nancy on Facebook?
No.
Still struggling?
Yeah.
Just in case somebody is distant and trying to get in today to look, maybe you can text them. Oh, see, you want me to stand over here, Nancy? Is that what you want? Okay, I'll stand right here. Text them and just let them know we're struggling a little bit on the Facebook Live, but we do always back that up with the other camera, and it will be loaded up on YouTube. Usually I say by noon on Monday, so we'll go home and render that and get it up online as quick as we can so people can view that. We'll keep trying to get Facebook up, but if not, why? We just have to live with it. We got 5G here, but it's just, I don't know whether it's a Facebook problem, an AT&T problem, or what, but.
AT&T problem.
Yeah, I don't know, but we have usually good service here with AT&T, so text them and just let them know that we're struggling with that. We'll keep trying, but I can't make any promises. But all that being said, again, welcome to the Queen Mahoning. This is our 15th outdoor worship here at the Queen Mahoning. 15 years we've been here, and praise the Lord, yep. 15 years, we started actually, anybody here for the first one in 2008? Nancy, Hoey, Edie, Lisa, yeah, a few of you. We were actually over there in that medium pavilion the first year, and then I think the second year we were pretty well outgrew that, and we set up a big tent beside it, and then I think the third year we ended up here, and we've been here ever since. So thanks for coming out today. Today is really about a day of worship. It's about a day of relaxation and fellowship. My encouragement about the church picnic is always to come out and worship and enjoy the Queen, but also spend some time getting to know each other, fellowshipping with people that you don't get to talk with very long in church on Sunday morning. Use the time here to just relax a little bit. We always say that we don't have a ton of things scheduled for you to do. Today is the Sabbath, and it's meant to rest and worship and honor God. The great news is we got some baptisms today as well, so we'll be leaving here and heading to the water at the end. We have three folks that have come and asked for baptism, and I would encourage everybody here to think about that, because that'll be opened up for everybody here. Anybody that wants to be baptized today, we will gladly give you that privilege today. So think about that, pray about that as we move forward this morning. So our centering words today to get us started in worship come from the book of Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 to 20. And it says, "For he being God, has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased our freedom and forgave our sins." That's what we're here to do today. That's the work and the mission of the church, to transfer those out of the kingdom of darkness and transfer them into the kingdom of God's Son, Jesus. So we're doing the work of the church today, the mission of the church today, and that's why we're here. Verse 15 goes on and says, "Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created, and is supreme over all creation. For through him God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things that we can't see, such as thrones and kingdoms and rulers and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him." That's a powerful verse. Everything was created for Jesus through him and for him. Verse 17 says he existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. Jesus is the glue. Jesus is what holds all creation together. Verse 18 says, "Christ is also the head of the church, which is his body. He is the beginning, supreme over all who rise from the dead. So he is first in everything. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and through him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. So today we honor Jesus. We honor what he did when he came to the baptism of waters. We honor him for being Lord, Savior, and the creator of all that exists. So pray with me this morning as we give some praise to God. Spend some moments silently just lifting up your own thoughts and prayers today. And I will lead you in our opening prayer this morning. So pray with me. Lord, today as we stand here in the Quemahoning Rec Park at the shores of the Quemahoning, Lord, we are again grateful to celebrate our 15th outdoor worship. Lord, we've come a fair way in those 15 years. In those first days when we started with a few, we've multiplied along the way. There's been quite a few baptisms, Lord. Today we're honored to call ourselves the Christian Church. We're honored, Lord, to continue to point to you and lead people to Christ, Lord. We're honored to be able to call ourselves Christian. We thank you that you are the image of the invisible God and that you existed before anything was created, and you're supreme over all creation and you hold all of creation together. Today, Lord, we've gathered to humble ourselves before you and to honor you and to worship you and to praise you for all of that. But mostly, Lord, we thank you for speaking into hearts. And today, Lord, we pray in a powerful way that you would speak into the hearts of everyone here this morning, those that are within the sound of my voice. Lord, stir in them if they've never ever thought about coming to you as and asking, inviting you to be their Lord and Savior. We pray today would be that day. So we pray for your spirit to rest upon us today. We pray that you would just bless each candidate that's coming today for baptism as they give their public profession of faith in you. We pray, Lord, that you would just bless the water today and that you would allow this very holy time to be just a real blessing, not only to the candidates that are being baptized, but to us as well, your church. So Father, we are just asking for your guidance and wisdom today. Be with us, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. All right, everybody should have a song sheet, and it should look something like this. And you'll need that a little bit later. Little sheet like this. The songs go in order. The first one is Great Are You, Lord. Revive Us Again is the offering. Then towards the end, we're going to invite people to come forward during Lord I Need You, and then before we head to the water, last one is Living Hope. I would encourage you, if you're on the back of that page now, to read that little couple paragraphs at the very end where it talks about baptism and what that means. I would also encourage you to flip it over to the front and look at the very first column under Way of Hope Christian Fellowship's title there, the criteria for fellowship. You'll need to have that handy as well, because this is one of the opportunities for us to recommit our faith to Jesus, and we'll be using those vows. So please keep that handy, but in the meantime, let's sing. Great Are You, Lord. Thank you. Got to find my stuff here.
What did I do?
Check. There you go. Got to find my stuff. Okay. There is an opportunity for you to give today. I just want to encourage you to think about if you, well, let me say it this way. There's opportunities for you to give today by text message or online. So let's try that. If you're in your swimsuit and the wallet's in the car and all that kind of stuff, you probably still have your cell phone close to you. You can text the word GIVE, G-I-V-E, to 814-259-5700. Text the word GIVE, 814-259-5700. Or you can go to easytithe.com/wayofhope, and you can give digitally this morning. We are going to pass around the bucket, so if you so feel inclined to support our ministry here, we thank you for doing that. It makes the ministry possible here. So let me pray with you, and I'll get the bucket moving around. And if you can use the digital, that's fine. We appreciate all that you do to support us here. So, Father, again, we are so grateful for your support here. We're grateful that we can just simply profess today that we've been here for 15 years and that we're doing the work that you called us to do, the mission of the church. So, Lord, today as we give, we thank you for the support that comes through each and every person here that faithfully gives, Lord, that gives whatever they can. We are grateful for all of it, Lord, little, small, big, doesn't matter. It all makes a big difference in the end. And today, Lord, we just want to give you the praise for it, and we want to thank you for it, and we want to thank each and everyone here that continues to give. So, Lord, bless this offering today. We ask again that you would encourage us to use it where you're working and show us the way, Lord. We always want to be where you are and doing your work. So we ask your blessings now in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. The bucket looks like this. So it's a coming around your way. And while it does, we can try to sing some more. I know the music's a little rough in the back there and in the middle, but let's try it again. Did that get all the way around back there? I know Em was carrying it around, so it's up here on the table if it missed you and you still want to put something in there. Thank you everybody for doing that though. Thanks for putting stuff in the bucket. It all makes a difference in the end and we're grateful for it. So let's take some time for some prayer requests. I need you to talk good and loud today so I can hear you. But things that you'd like to share prayer-wise this morning, prayer request. I'll start with my list so I don't forget. As I got a few on here and some information you're probably excited to know. First thing we want to pray for Mel Inks' aunt, Barb Landis. She was in the hospital with a COPD flare-up. She doing better, Mel?
She's doing better, yeah. I mean, it's an ongoing thing, but definitely better than what she was.
Okay, and want to keep your cousin Tammy Kimmel in prayer, too, who's getting a biopsy for a cancer biopsy. So keep her in prayer. Want to keep Gail Swain's friend, Linda Droluck, in prayer, who's having a knee replacement coming this week on the 25th. Also, Janice Baker has raised up her niece's son, George. You've heard me say a little bit about him over the last couple weeks. George is 18, had a mass in his lung. They've discovered that he has testicular cancer, and that has moved up into the lungs. Understand he was in the hospital in the ER this week, and he was vomiting up blood, so things are not good for George. He's got some sort of lung cancer going on too. So if you could keep George in prayer and his mother Carrie and Janice and that family in your prayer, we would appreciate it. Want to keep Jim Simcoe in prayer as well. We've been ongoing praying for him and Miss Carolyn. His blood count is low and he's still in therapy, going to be there for another week. He thought he was going to come home this week. They're keeping him another week just to build up some strength and to watch his blood count. So keep Jim and Carolyn in your prayers. Want to keep Diane Hosopo in prayer. She had some surgery this week on Tuesday, to remove some melanoma on her forehead. So please keep her in prayer. Also, it's good to see Chris back home. He traveled up north for his dad's funeral. So wanted to just remember him and safe travel, and he's back, so that's good. Also, want to keep the Tawnies in prayer, Ben and Selena. They thought maybe they might be here. I don't think they are unless they snuck in since. But this Tuesday, very early in the morning, somewhere around 2:30 somewhere a.m., little Finley Dale Tawny came into the world. So little boy, and they're rejoicing in all that, happy. It was a little rough start for a little Finley, I guess, when he was delivered. He had some complications, but they got him fixed up, and he was hollering and wiggling his hands and or fingers and toes, so all is good. So just prayers of Thanksgiving. Babies are miraculous, and they're a great gift from God, and we just praise God for that today. So, things that you'd like to pray for, good and loud, if you got a prayer request, so I can hear you. Go ahead, Edie, let's start with you.
My friend Phyllis from the building I live in,
okay.
She had a stroke.
All right.
And she's in the hospital right now, so.
All right. So I want to keep Edie's friend Phyllis in prayer, lives in the same building, had a stroke. Okay. Go ahead, Charlotte.
The little girl we've been praying for, Riley, who had 7 years old, who has cancer, passed away last night.
Mm.
So we need to remember her family. They had quite a struggle.
Okay. So the little girl Riley that Charlotte and Rod have been praying for was 7 years old, passed away last night from, did she have cancer? Or
yes.
Cancer, yeah. So please keep that family in your prayers. That's probably one of the hardest things that anybody goes through is losing a child. So please keep little Riley's family in prayer. Who else? Go ahead back there, Kayla, good and loud so I can hear you.
My coworker's daughter, Aubrey, gets her surgery
on December. Got it. Little Aubrey, 1 year old, right?
I go to children Wednesday night or Thursday morning.
Okay, so she has surgery 27th, as I remember, for her brachial cleft. So please keep little Aubrey in prayer. Kayla, was that you that had your hand up back there or somebody beside you? Who was it? Oh, I see you, Kathy. Go ahead.
For Jim, he's trailering his motorcycle out to South Dakota today, and he's going to be riding out to South Dakota.
All right. So safe travel for Jim as he's trailering along and riding motorcycle in South Dakota. All right. Good deal. Little R&R vacation there, huh? Go ahead.
My little niece, Autumn, she fell into a lake 2 days ago.
Autumn. How old's little Autumn?
10.
So it's Jacob, right?
Yes.
I'm going to keep Jacob's, what is it?
Niece.
Autumn. She's 10 years old. Fell and broke her leg. Okay. Go ahead, Mary.
Well, with all the darkness that's happening in the world right now, I find it very hard to find the light. And we've been struggling to find formula for Avery. And I have had everybody looking, and my sisters went for a drive the other day, and I had sent my WIC card with them to see if they could find formula wherever they went, you know.
Right.
And they went to the Giant Eagle in Ligonier, and they had my WIC card. They got 5 cans of formula, but when they went up to the register, they don't participate in the WIC program. The lady that was behind them, that actually let them go in front of her, she paid for all 5 cans of formula.
Wow. Praise the Lord. See, there's still... Go ahead. That's right. The Lord needs praised over that. There is still light in the world, and God shows us that from time to time. Go ahead.
I actually have a friend that's traveling to Texas that she's sending me 5 more cans of formula from Kentucky right now. They should be here Tuesday.
All right. Praise the Lord. Good. Good. It is a shame that formula is so hard to find even still after pandemic's kind of behind us now. So, who else? Anybody else? Go ahead. Way back there in the back.
I just had a praise for answered prayer. I don't know, I was laying in bed last night. I was praying before I fell asleep. And for a long time, those prayers would usually bring me to tears. And last night, for the first time in a really long time, I smiled while I was praying. And it was the most enlightening, empowering, wholesome feeling in the world. And so I thank everybody at Wake Hope for everything they did for me over the last few months, weeks. And I just praise for answered prayers.
All right. Praise for answered prayers. Amen. God still is in the business of answering prayer. All right, last call. Let's come to the Lord in prayer, spend some time silently, and then we'll make our way to the message this morning. So join me as we pray. Lord, again, we just want to pause and thank you again for this beautiful day to start with, that we can gather together outside. We can worship you, Lord, in your creation. We can look all around us, hear the birds singing, and see the beauty of the water, and just the beautiful day. And we can know and understand that this is a witness to us that you are who you say you are, the creator of the world. And all of this creation and beauty is miraculous around us that reminds us that we have a Savior and we have a Lord. And today, Lord, we're grateful to be here to honor you and to praise you and to lift up our worship to you. Lord, today it's a good day. Again, the mission of the church, Lord, is to call believers to public profession, to allow them, Lord, to join your kingdom. And today, Lord, we're blessed and privileged to be able to participate in this holy day. So, Lord, we ask that, again, that you would continue to pour out your blessings today on each and every one. We pray that you would remind them that you very much are real, that there is still very much light in the world today. We know that the world is filled with tons of darkness. We know that there are many lost and unsaved. Today, Lord, we pray that you would speak in a powerful way into our hearts and encourage us to be your disciples and to go out into the world and make disciples of all nations, Lord. We pray that you would give us the courage and wherewithal. You've reminded us that the Holy Spirit is with us and will never forsake us. It'll give us the words to say when we need it. So we pray, Lord, that you would give us just the motivation and wherewithal to continue, Lord, to be salt and light in the world and reach out and make a difference. Lord, we know this woman standing in a grocery line. We don't know anything about her, but we know that she did a powerful thing. We ask your blessings on her, Lord, for such a great and compassionate, gracious thing. Lord, help us to be those kind of people. Help us to bring light into the darkness. Lord, today as we make our way to the message, we're just again asking for you to open up our hearts and minds to hear. Lord, we're going to talk a little bit about baptism, something that you've created and showed us to do. And we pray, Lord, that you'll help us to be mindful of how holy this particular event is. We lift up again to you all of these names that have been listed today. We ask for your powerful hand of healing and blessing to wash over them. Lord, be with us today as we worship and we relax. We pray that you would just anoint us with your Holy Spirit. Allow us some rest and some Sabbath, Lord. Today we pray all this today in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So, the question I want to ask this morning as we kind of get started here is baptism really still an important thing in today's world? We've been blessed to be here for 15 years in an outdoor worship. I think just about every year we've had the opportunity to baptize somebody. So that's always been a privilege. We've had several years where people just moved right out of, you know, the congregation here that wasn't really even pre-planned and went to the baptismal water. But, you know, we do live in a very dark world today. And the question is asked pretty frequently, is baptism still important? There's a ton of polls, there's a ton of statistics that say that Christianity is declining, and it's declining rapidly. I just read a survey the other day that said back in the early 70s there was about 70% of the people that claimed to be Christian, and now that's down somewhere in the mid 50% that claim to be Christian. So the question is baptism really still important? And we can say with certainty that Jesus thought it was. If you turn to Matthew chapter 3, starting in verse 13, that particular passage talks about Jesus' baptism specifically. And it says in verse 13, it says, "Then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. But John tried to talk him out of it. He said, 'I'm the one who needs to be baptized by you. So why are you coming to me?' But Jesus said, 'It should be done, for we must carry out all that God requires.' So John agreed to baptize him. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my dearly loved son who brings me great joy." That last two verses there, after Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my dearly loved son who brings me great joy." Those two verses keep in your mind as we work through the message. When we talk about Christian baptism, it really is a religious ceremony, or what we call a holy sacrament. Sacrament is a religious ceremony in the church. It's a holy sacrament. Many of us have witnessed baptism dozens of times. Many of you have seen it. Many of you have experienced it here. The pastor invites those who desire to be baptized to come forward. We'll do that a little later. There's some statements about Christian baptism that are read. Sometimes there's some scripture. And then those that have come forward are asked to see if they agree to be baptized into the Christian faith. The questions that are asked are things like, do they desire to publicly testify that Jesus Christ is their Savior and Lord? Do they commit for the rest of their lives to obey God's holy will and keep His commandments? And will they be loyal to the church, which is the body of Christ? And those that agree are then led down to the water. You've watched this before, where the sacrament of baptism is experienced. Here at Way of Hope, we baptize by immersion three times forward. Each person is baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. I can't explain it to you. I've never had a person really come back to me and say, "Oh, my baptism was a horrible experience." I have a lot of people that have come back to me and say, "It's been one of the most moving and beautiful experiences of my entire life. God really was present. I felt the Holy Spirit, and it was an awesome day." But some of the questions that are being asked today in the 21st century church are, does baptism mean anything today? Does it do anything? Does it have any power? Does it have any significance? Or is it just simply some old-fashioned ritual of days gone by? Now, let's be honest with each other for a minute, because this is church, and we can be honest with each other, right? You still awake? Can you hear me all the way back there? You got it? We can be honest with each other, right? We've all watched an individual or two go into the baptismal water and come out on the other side with no more change in their lives than having gotten wet. You know what I'm talking about? From all appearances, it looks like they would become a really powerful witness for Jesus at school, at home, at work, wherever. And yet, a couple years later, they're still cursing and drinking and spreading malicious gossip, hanging out with the wrong crowd. You getting the picture? What I'm trying to say? They are living the polar opposite of the life of a Christ follower. Instead of bringing honor and glory to the Lord, they're bringing shame and dishonor. Now, the problem isn't with Christian baptism. The problem has never been with Christian baptism. In fact, the problem can never be with baptism. The problem is, it lies in us human beings in our spiritual life. Now, as difficult as this might be to say, the truth is that either those persons never came to a sincere faith, or they've really allowed the devil to once again enslave them into a life of rebellion and sin. You and I know folks like that, and I would encourage you to pray for them. It's imperative this morning that we have a really clear biblical view and understanding about Christian baptism and a respect for what it truly is. It truly is a holy sacrament. We need to understand its importance. We need to understand how it transforms our nature and spirit. We need to understand that it's a sacrament of grace. We need to understand the identity that we align ourselves with when we're baptized. Simply put, we need to understand what it means to live the baptismal life. So let's look at Jesus for a moment and just look at how he viewed baptism. Verse 13 says, that Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. At that point, John was anointed by God to perform baptisms. He was out in the Jordan and he was baptizing away. And Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. And the first thing that we see in that very verse is this very importance of baptism. The Lord's baptism didn't happen by accident. Jesus' baptism was premeditated. It was calculated. It was intentional. Verse 13 says that he came from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. Now, what you might not know is this was at least a 5-day trip, one way, walking. You know, no buses, no cars, nothing like that. 5-day trip walking. And that's if you were able to walk 15 miles a day. So this wasn't a drive-by baptism. Jesus' baptism was something that had been well thought out and planned. Because let's be honest, no rational person would start off on such a long trip walking on a mere whim. So let's really look at what the trip involved. First, it was a minimum of a 75-mile trip, okay? Walking from Galilee to the Jordan, 75 miles. It would mean traveling through King Herod's kingdom, along with traveling through the territory under the leadership of Pontius Pilate. It would mean traveling through the land of the Samaritans. Jews didn't even like Samaritans, and Samaritans didn't like Jews, right? Now, at first glance, it might seem like that's not really a big deal. I mean, after all, it's only 75 miles. Anybody here want to walk 75 miles and get baptized today? No. And traveling in Jesus' day was anything but easy. When you traveled from one territory to the next, it meant that you dealt with different rules and different leaders. Each man who ruled his own little kingdom liked to have his own little rules in his kingdom. And then there was those long, lonely stretches of road. And on those long stretches of lonely road, you know who hung out there? Thieves. You had to be on the lookout for thieves. Remember the parable of the Good Samaritan? Do you remember that parable? A guy walking on the road gets beat up, left in a ditch for dead. That was very, very, very serious. It happened all the time. Those attacks were the work of terrorists. And if the thieves were unlucky enough to get caught, they were quickly tried and they were immediately crucified. Their dying and dead bodies would line the highways as a deterrent to other people who wanted to cause trouble kind of on these lonely stretches. And it wasn't unusual in those days to see sections of the highway that were littered with dozens of crosses, some of them empty, some of them being used. And we all think that those long lines in the airport today are rough, right? I mean, traveling was difficult whenever Jesus was here. And if all that wasn't enough, travelers had to keep a keen eye out for the wild beasts. The hills were full of caves, and they were full of lions and bears that were known to ambush people. And then there was the venomous snakes and the scorpions. Anyone traveling in those days had to be well prepared and ready to defend themselves at a moment's notice. Traveling was not easy, and yet Jesus walked 75 miles at least from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized. Now we have to keep in mind that Jesus was also most likely traveling by himself. He was being led by the Holy Spirit to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. And we know that it's still about 2 months before he's going to call any of his disciples. And soon after he's baptized, where does Jesus go? Goes into the wilderness, right, for 40 days to be tempted by the devil. So we can pretty much imagine that Jesus was alone walking to be baptized. And all this points to the reality that Jesus' baptism was a very important event. And we know that simply because all four of the gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they all write about this important story. Anytime you see the same story written about 4 times by each of the gospel writers in the Bible, that is an important story. Jesus' baptism was that important. Now, not only did our gospel writers see baptism as important, but so does the rest of the New Testament. This idea of an unbaptized believer is not found in the New Testament anywhere. From the beginnings of the church, baptism has always been at the forefront of the Christian church. In Acts chapter 2, if you remember, we just studied this a few weeks ago, when the Apostle Peter was asked how to respond to his Pentecost message, this is what he had to say. Do you remember this? Peter replied, "Each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God," important, "and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." So we see in that statement from Peter that repentance of sin was first and foremost. That's the first step. One had to repent of their sin and ask Christ into their heart. And afterwards, one was to be baptized and then filled with the power and presence of God's Holy Spirit. The Apostle Peter himself couldn't have been more clear about the importance of repentance and baptism and the infilling presence of the Holy Spirit. As you fast forward a little bit, by 80 AD, the idea of someone coming into faith without baptism was thought to be virtually impossible. St. Hermas, one of the early church fathers, he writes about baptism and he says that there is no other repentance except that which took place when he went down into the water and obtained the remission of our former sin. A little later on, Origen, writing in 235 AD, had this to share. He said, "It is not possible to receive forgiveness of sin without baptism." Now, I don't know if I'll go all that far, but you can see how important baptism is in the early church. All of this shows us from the very beginning, starting with our Lord and going through all of his apostles to the days of the early church, Christian baptism was essential. Christian baptism has never ever been a suggestion or an option. Our Lord shows us that we all must come to the water. Baptism is a holy sacrament, and it's something that should not be taken lightly or put to the side. There are three things that are essential to us as Christian people, and those three things are repentance and baptism and being filled with the Holy Spirit. And it's as true today as it was on the day the Apostle Peter at Pentecost preached that. Today, if we've repented of our sins, then we need to make sure that we take those next two steps, being filled with the Spirit and baptism. Now, the second thing that Jesus teaches us is about this life-changing nature of baptism. And I tell people about this all the time. Unless you experience it, maybe you don't fully understand it, but there is some life-changing when someone sincerely repents and makes a public profession of faith. Sadly, some people look at baptism as being no more than simply a ritual involving the use of water. And it's really, in their opinion, that baptism is just a symbol or a sign. And if we're going to fully understand all of this, the life-changing nature of baptism, let's go back to the creation story for a minute. The writer of Genesis tells us that on day one and day two, the Lord God created what? The waters, right? And then he divided them. Nearly three quarters of our world is covered by water. Our Lord God created water and he made it essential for life on our planet. At our birth, water accounts for nearly 80% of our body weight. The lungs that we use to breathe are made up of 80% water. Our heart and our brain are made up of 70% water. Even your bones are made up of 30 to 35% water. Everybody here under this roof or outside of the roof of this pavilion, everybody here is primarily made up of water. And we all know the importance of water. We need water to survive. We don't need food so much. We can survive for weeks without food. We can only last a few days without water. So it's not by accident that the Lord chose to use water as a means of teaching us something and dispensing grace and mercy and love. As essential as water is to the human body, so too baptismal water is important and essential to the human spirit. As essential as water is to the human body, so too is the Lord's living water to our spiritual soul. We say that all the time, right? Jesus is the living water. The Lord has chosen the medium of water to bring us physical and spiritual healing and purity and wholeness. When you go back and look at the Old Testament, the Jews viewed water as something holy and sacred. They were in awe of water. They were in awe of its power and its majesty. Water was a force that they knew that they couldn't conquer. They couldn't walk on it. They couldn't command it. They couldn't obey it. Water was something that only the Lord God Almighty could control. Only the Lord could cause water to fall from the sky and fill up the oceans and lakes and streams. Only the Lord could command water to bring about blessings and healings and favor. How many times in the scriptures do you read where one of the apostles or Jesus himself says, go to the water and dip yourself in it and you'll be healed? In our passage this morning, we see how the Lord transformed the baptismal waters of John the Baptist. Martin Luther wrote a long time ago about how the Lord Jesus sanctified baptism with his body, and how the Holy Spirit sanctified baptism with his holy presence, and how the Holy Father sanctified baptism with his voice. Remember those last two verses? When Jesus came out of the water, the Spirit came down, and the voice from heaven said, "This is my Son who is well pleased." All three of those things happened when Jesus was baptized. His body sanctified the water, the Holy Spirit sanctified with his presence, and the Holy Father sanctified with his voice. Jesus made baptism holy. Now listen carefully. The baptismal water is more than just a collection of H2O atoms. Baptismal water is water in which our Lord bathed, it's water that the Holy Spirit lingered over, and it's water that our Heavenly Father preached over. Again, listen to those two verses. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my dearly loved Son, who brings me great joy." If you're familiar with the Eastern Orthodox Church tradition, our friends over there believe that baptism is one of God's most beautiful and magnificent gifts to his redeemed children. It's their belief that when one enters into the waters of baptism, that one does not enter into the water alone. They believe that when one enters into the water, one does so along the presence of God's holiness and his love and its grace. And when you think about that, what a beautiful picture of baptism that is this morning. God enters the water with you in his presence, his holiness, his love, and his grace. The Lord joins us in the water, and it's in his name that we are baptized. It's the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit that we come to faith. It's his name that redeems us and renews us and restores us. And seriously, we wouldn't say those words if we were just simply immersing our physical bodies in the water. We wouldn't need those words. The plain fact that we are being baptized in the name of the Holy Trinity reveals to us the life-changing nature of baptism. You're being baptized into God's family in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. It's the sign of being born again in water and spirit. Remember, Jesus talked about that. John chapter 3, Jesus said, "I tell you the truth, unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." "What do you mean?" exclaimed Nicodemus. "How can an old man go back into his mother's womb and be born again?" And Jesus replied, "I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised when I say, you must be born again." Think about this for a minute. The tabernacle and the temple were simply buildings, right, in the Old Testament. The Ark of the Covenant was simply a golden chest. But you know what happened with those things? The tabernacle and the temple were more than buildings. Why? Because God's presence was there. The Ark of the Covenant was more than a golden chest. Why? Because the presence of God was there. They became holy because of the presence of the Lord. So too does the baptismal water. Baptism is a sacrament. It's been sanctified, I should say, by the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And Jesus makes very clear it's important for us physically, and it's important for us spiritually. Let me wrap up with just one more point. Baptism really does remind us of our sacred agreement with the Lord. The early church father Tertullian, when asked about baptism, had this to say. He said, when we are going to enter the water, listen carefully, we solemnly profess that we disown the devil, his pomp, and his angels. Listen to them again. When we are going into the water, we solemnly profess that we disown the devil, his pomp, and his angels. It was the primary understanding of the early church that baptism signified a change in identity, a change in allegiance. When one left the waters of baptism, one entered into a life of spiritual transformation through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. When one left the waters of baptism, one was testifying from that day forward, Jesus Christ would be their Savior and Lord. When one of them left the waters of baptism, one was consecrating themselves to a lifelong relationship of increasing holiness, which would lead them to being restored into the image of Jesus. Do you understand what happens here when you profess Jesus and Lord? We're supposed to be growing and increasing in holiness. I want to make clear this morning, and I said this last week too, another way, belief is not the goal of Christianity. Belief is not the goal of Christianity. Maturity is. Spiritual maturity is. Far too often we've seen people who appear to come to faith, and when they go into the water, and in a matter of weeks, they're no longer dedicated to living a relationship of increasing holiness. We watch as their lives are not transformed. We watch as their lives do not bear any fruit of righteousness. That's one of the most disheartening things for the pastor. I'm afraid that those individuals, again, have accepted a lie from the devil. And I'm afraid that they've accepted the lie that baptism is some sort of a water seal that enables them to live any way they choose. You know, the truth is, Christian baptism allows us to live out this beautiful and growing relationship with the Lord God Himself. It allows us to live out a relationship of increasing holiness. When you go back and look at the Apostle John, he had a similar problem here. And he wrote about it in 1 John chapter 2. And some of those who had come to Christ back then were under this opinion that after they were baptized, confessed Jesus as Lord and Savior, that they could live any way that they wanted to because, hey, they were saved now, so it really didn't matter, right? They saw nothing wrong in giving in to the lust of the flesh and the desires of the eyes or the pride of life. They saw nothing wrong with their spirit living one way while their physical being lived another way. Do you hear what I'm saying? Over and over in his letter, the Apostle John combats this heretical teaching. He is clear to point out that such beliefs are not only mistaken, they have their origin in the liars of liars, the devil. You cannot live one way in your flesh and another way in your spirit. Here's the issue in a nutshell. If the devil can deceive us to believe that we can have a spirit that's in tune with the Lord, and a body that is living by the worldly desires of the flesh, then he has once again defeated us and enslaved us. Do you hear what I'm saying? We're to live a consistent life. Jesus provides the power to remove both the penalty of sin and the power of sin in and from our lives. In Christ, we are no longer condemned to devil's hell, nor are we condemned to be enslaved by sin. Jesus came to give us life, and life more abundantly. That means that he came to save us, he came to enable us through the Holy Spirit to live a relationship of holiness. Now, the truth is, we're all going to still be tempted. And the devil's never going to give up. He wants nothing more from you than for you to fail and be under his control again. Again, that's why the Apostle Paul's letters encourages us to, and challenges us to fight the good fight, to put on the armor of God, and to put to death the sins of the body. A life of victory is assured as long as we remember who is Savior and Lord of our lives. In Christ, we can be victorious. And our baptism constantly reminds us of this fact. We have died to our sins, and we have been made alive in Christ. We are a new creation. We are no longer citizens here of this world. We are sons and daughters of the Lord God Almighty. Our work now is to be disciples of Christ. Our work now is to grow in faith. Our work now is to emulate the ways of Jesus. And that was the practice of the early church, the early disciples of Jesus. We're going to see this in a couple of weeks in Acts chapter 11. We see it happening in Antioch. The believers had repented of their sins. They had experienced Christian baptism. They received the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And now they were experiencing this great transformation of their very identity. They were emulating the way of Jesus so much that those people around that were looking at them gave them this nickname of Little Christ. These people are acting like Christ. These are little Christ, or where we get the word Christian. There's no better compliment for a follower of Jesus to be called a Christian. It meant that they were experiencing a relationship with Jesus, and they were transforming their heart, their mind, and their soul. It means that they're being restored into the very image of Jesus. It meant that they were becoming one with the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. That nickname and that experience is the same one that the Lord has for each of us this morning. He desires more than ever for us to be identified with Him, for us to be restored into His image, and part of that transformation occurs when we accept and repent and accept Jesus as Lord. And we're baptized. We live that out in our baptism every day. So all that being said, baptism is incredibly important still today. That's the answer to the first question. It's always been important. It's always been holy. Jesus saw to that. It's part of what we do to emulate who Jesus is. So today, if you'd like to invite Jesus into your life, if you've never done that as Savior and Lord, if you've never considered Jesus into your heart and being a part of your life, I really want to invite you to think about that and join me up here in the front. There's no way that I can really describe to you the experience. It's powerful. People have said to me over and over the years how they felt the Holy Spirit in God's presence as they were baptized. I can tell you from my own account that I believe that's very much true in my own baptism. If you've made that commitment, if you've repented somewhere along the line and you've accepted Jesus as Savior and Lord, but you've never been baptized, today's a great time to do that. I want to invite you to join me up here as well. We have lots of towels here. We can get you a change of clothes. We can get your clothes dry for you. Don't be hindered by the idea, if you make a decision this morning, that, well, I didn't bring clothes and all that stuff. We'll take care of that the best that we can for you. If you hear God calling today, I want to encourage you to answer Him, to listen to Him, to come forward as we sing today. To those that have already made the decision, Abby Kniss way back there in the back, Gabe and Chrissy Inc. sitting there in the middle, I want to encourage them to come forward as well. So, again, if God is touching your heart today, if God is speaking to you, if God is asking you to make a public profession for Him today, I encourage you to listen to Him and to respond to that. So pray with me. Heavenly Lord, as we take this step of baptism, we ask that You would lead us onward into the long journey to which You've called all of us. Father, the step of baptism was one of the most important moments in our Christian walk. So today we ask that you would help us to approach this act of dedication with a clear mind, with sincere hearts, and a contrite spirit. Lord, there's nothing simply more powerful than giving our lives to you. We pray today that you would stir in hearts, Lord, and that you would help people to hear your call and respond in kind. We pray this today in Jesus' name. Amen. As we listen to the song, I invite you to come forward if God so moves you. Abby, Chris, Gabe, come forward then too. Stand, the three of you, please. If you have that little sheet, I'm going to switch sides with you. If you have that sheet, your song sheet, you're going to need that in a minute because there's a congregational response there that's going to be part of your duty as we ask these three questions to these three folks up here. But before we do that, I do want to get a little testimony from them, and then we'll go through the three questions, and then I'm going to turn to you and ask those same three baptismal questions to you. This is also an opportunity for you to renew your baptismal vows this morning as well. So, I'll start with Abby since you're right next to me. My question to them always is, why do you want to be baptized? Why do you want to give your life to Jesus? So I'll let them make a little statement about that.
So I've had a rough couple of years, and I really had to lean on my faith to get me through those times, and that really helped me and changed me as a person, I think. And I made the commitment as I was younger, and I asked the Lord to be my Savior, and I was baptized as a baby, but I never made the step to get baptized as an adult, and I just thought that this would be the right time to do that.
Miss Chrissy.
Hello. So, I've had a lot of trouble with being Christian much, so I've been deciding to get baptized to get closer to God and to wash my sins away.
Yeah, I just want to get closer to God and, He can, be my Savior and, wash my sins away.
All right. Did you go out to Camp Park as a kid? All of these three up here, it's come to my attention anyways, that both Gabe and Chrissy were at Camp Park this year to serve as peer buddies. Abby's been out there too in the past, is that so? Working diligently just to be a good advocate and a Christian influence in people's lives. So blessings and kudos to the both of you for that. Today is a precious day where they make a public profession of their faith. Today you're being received into this community of faith and into the family of God. As part of the whole Church of Jesus Christ, we offer you our rich heritage and invite you to share fully in our life and mission. As you are received into Way of Hope Christian Fellowship, we intend to be a true family of faith to you. We commit ourselves to be for you a loving fellowship, to be a means of grace in your life, and to offer opportunities for worship, study, and service. One of the happiest times in our life as a church is when believers choose to become members of the family of God. We welcome you both, all three, with joy. Now, I got three questions for you, and I'll look at each one of you to answer accordingly. So let's start with the first. Do you believe that Jesus is God's Son? And do you receive and trust him as your Savior and Lord? Abby?
Yes.
Chris? Okay. Number two, will you turn away from all sin and will you endeavor by God's grace to live according to the example and teachings of Jesus?
Yes.
Chrissy?
Yes.
Okay. Will you be loyal to the church, upholding it by your prayers and your presence, your substance, and your service?
Yes.
Chris?
Yes.
You, the congregation, can I ask you to stand? There's a response in the midst of that song sheet that you have, congregational response. Would you stand and share that in unison back to these three? You ready? With joy, we receive you as part of this congregation. With you, we renew and affirm our vows of faith. We promise to surround you with the love and encouragement that will enable you to grow strong in compassion, vigorous in service, and sure in the ways of Christ. And now may the blessings of God be upon all who have made new and renewed commitments this day. And may we go forth together in service, glorifying God's name and responding to our neighbor's needs. Amen. You all can have a seat for a moment. I'll be back to you in a minute. There's a bag right behind you. Just hang on 1 second and Denise will get that for you. We have a gift here for everybody. A little devotional in each one. Make sure you take those home. There's a baptismal certificate in there and also an order of service. So that's for Chris C. and Gabe. And then there's one for Miss Abby.
Thank you.
All right. To you, the congregation. Anybody else want to say anything up here before we move on? Nope. For you, the congregation, if you'll notice on that song sheet, the criteria for fellowship is first and foremost, to confess and accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and live by His teaching. That is the number one criteria for belonging to the church. If you look down over there, we request your presence. That's regular attendance, your provision, your faithful giving and prayer support, your participation, your loyal service, volunteering, witnessing, praying for the church, and those kinds of things. Under that attendance register, we've done away with that since COVID, but that may be coming back again in the fall. That really is kind of helpful to me. But the baptismal vows are there before you. And again, I want to ask each and every one of you, again, to respond to these three vows. So to you, the congregation, do you believe that Jesus is God's Son? And do you receive and trust Him as your Savior and Lord? Respond in kind. Will you turn away from all sin, and will you endeavor by God's grace to live according to the example and teachings of Jesus?
Yes.
Will you be loyal to the church, upholding it by your prayers and your presence, your substance, and your service?
Yes.
God's blessings to all of you. Bear in mind those commitments that you make to God. They are powerful, and you need to honor them. Amen? All right. Let's stand, stretch our legs a little bit again, and we'll sing out, and we'll head to the water. Give us about 5 minutes to make some shoe changes after we're done singing, and we'll see everybody down at the shoreline. So let's sing. Okay.
Thank you.
with me one more time. We'll pray for the food so that after we're done down at the water, you can come back and start to enjoy some fellowship together. So join me as we pray. Lord, today as we depart from here and head to the water, I pray for those that have renewed their commitment to live for you. May you fill them with courage to live boldly in your name. We pray for those that come to the water, Lord, and ask for the infilling of your Holy Spirit, that they might increase in holiness and the image of Jesus Christ. Today, Lord, as well, we pray for our fellowship and our food. We thank you for providing it. We thank you for all the hands that have prepared it. And we thank you for the opportunity to sit and enjoy it. Today, Lord, this day is committed to you, and we're thankful that we can rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, we ask your blessings now in Jesus' name. Amen. See you in the water in a couple of minutes.
Chrissy, upon your confession of faith made before God and these people, you are baptized in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Pray with me. Today, God, we are thankful for the commitment made by Chrissy. May she experience your forgiveness, acceptance, and peace. Send your Holy Spirit upon her to guide and empower. Enable her to walk in newness of life, using her gifts in praise to you and in service to others. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. All right, girl. Give me a hug. You're going to make me wet. All right. Gabe, upon your confession of faith before God and these people, you are baptized in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Again, Father, we are thankful for the commitment made here today by Gabe. May he experience your forgiveness and acceptance and peace. Send your Holy Spirit upon him to guide and empower. Enable him to walk in newness of life, using his gifts in praise to you and in service to others. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. All right, man. Upon your confession of faith before God and these people, you are baptized in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Lord, again we ask and thank you for the commitment today made by Abby. May she experience your forgiveness, acceptance, and peace. Send your Holy Spirit upon her to guide and empower. Enable her to walk in newness of life, using her gifts in praise to you and in service to others. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.